Okay, so we are seeing last time the basic meaning of Tattvamasi. And we also saw that 19th verse. Where is now from the 19th verse onwards, he is going into various possible misinterpretations of Tattvamasi. Okay. No. Pratyaktvam meaning what you can objectify. Body, mind, etc. That giving up. Yeah. Because aparokshatvam you are not giving up. But pratyaktvam of the body, mind, etc. you are giving up. Because that is also taken as self. No? You're getting the thing. No? Body, mind, etc. is taken as the self. So even tattvamasi from tvam, those things have to be given up. Yeah, that's all. And paraktvam, that Ishvara is nitya parokshaha. Yeah, that is easy to understand. Yeah. Pratyaktvam. Paraktvam is parokshaha. Ishvara is nitya parokshaha. So that paroksham aspect has to be given up. So all that we saw. Yeah. See, that's what he, let me sum it up. In the last verse, what he had, in the last 2-3 verses, what we had seen is, in our normal understanding of Ishvara and normal understanding of the individual, we take ourselves as a composite whole. Body, mind, pranas, reasoning, knowledge, ignorance, and consciousness. All of it is taken as one. I. We are not fully aware of the mix-up here. That certain things that are seen by us are also taken as us, as me. Body is seen by me. It's an instrument. It's an object of my awareness. It's a vikari one. All that is true. But all that is taken as I. So in the very way the sentence is presented, it can become meaningful only if from the meaning of the word tvam, all this is dropped. From the meaning of the word I, all this is dropped. And it can be dropped only because it is not true. If it was true, it cannot be dropped. That's why he uses the word pratyaktva. All that you can is pratyaksha with respect to yourself. What do you mean by pratyaksha? What is perceivable? Perception. Directly perceivable. Yeah. And what is perception in Vedanta?
That is five senses what they report.
What is perception? I want the explanation of the word perception, not what five senses. What is perception? What we are technically put it as? Okay, all those who are coming from the camp is going to get a good dose about this, okay?
Direct immediate knowledge.
Where the object of knowledge, the knowing mind, the which takes the form of the object, and the knower is in one and the same place. Yeah, that is perception. All this I'll clarify more in the camp. Those who are coming from the camp are in for a good dose of it. Okay, I'm going to do the... I think now I'm taking the decision. I've still kept it open. I will keep most of the camp on epistemology in Vedanta. How do we know what we know? And how is it applicable to the self? The whole question of epistemology will rise. Okay. Some of you have got it in Vedanta Paribhasha. Yes. So, therefore, what is pratyakshaha? In common parlance, yes, what is seen by me through one or more of the sense organs. With the help of, you always need the sense organs, not without that. But mind, etc., do you need the sense organs? No. Therefore, that's why the other definition comes into play. Sakshi Vetyam, otherwise we'll call it. So all this is taken as myself. Similarly, Ishvara is taken as away from me, as other than me. If you understand Ishvara is a cosmic order, as Abhinna Nimitta Upadana Karanam etc., you will take yourself as part. Why? Because you are taking yourself as a body. The moment you say Abhinna Nimitta Upadana Karanam, what are you talking about? Manifestation. The manifested universe, no? Therefore, I will become again the finite being. Therefore, both these aspects from Ishvara and Jiva has to be negated. And only the pure consciousness can be understood from the statement Tattvamasi. So, before he goes into the details of these, he is doing it very elaborately, he will deal with this. The whole verse is about that only. So, before going into the actual elaborate meaning, in dealing with it, he is dealing with the various possibilities of misinterpretation. Like one we saw last time. Parasya amsho vikaro va jiva vakena na uchyate. By tattvamasi, it cannot imply tasya tvamasi. You belong to Ishvara. Meaning you are part of him. If I become a part of Ishvara, Ishvara becomes a finite entity. Because me multiplied by so many billion times should become Ishvara then. And that is not the definition of Ishvara. Whether you are taking it as Satyam Jnanam Anantam or Janmadhyasthi Yataha, all pervading this, that, Ishvara is unconditioned by time and space. I neither meaning. Ishvara is unconditioned by time and space. Therefore, I cannot be an amshaha or a vikara of Ishvara, a modification. If I am modification, then Ishvara is no more there, only I am there. Yeah. It's like that foolish interpretation. Sadaiva saumi idamagram asit ekameva advitiyam brahman. Before all this, what was there was one Brahman. Then from Brahman, the world came. Like I had 1 kilo of atta. From 1 kilo of atta, I made 50 fulkas. Abhi kya atta hai kya fulka hai? Only chapatis are there, there is no more atta. So if you are saying I am a vikara, there is no more God left. Ishvara is not there anymore. Only I am there. Now you can deal with me. Ishvara is not there. So such type of meanings are foolish. That's not the meaning of Sadeva Soumya. Yeah. Because before making that statement, he has also talked about the mithyatvam of any creation. That all creation is mithya, what is there is only the content. In anything, the content is the truth. All creation is only name and form. That he has elaborately dealt with before. Then he is saying all this. So satyamithya has already been established. So to take the atta example, roti example for Sadeva Soumya is not tenable. So vikara it cannot be. So neither amsha, a part, or a vikara. Because there are various misinterpretations of tattvamasi like that. By saying tasya tvamasi, etc. Because tattvam, if you write together, it becomes like a samasa. So you belong to him. You are part of him. Separate he doesn't consider. The pure Dvaitic school he doesn't consider because Tattvamasi he said. Unless you want to put it as Atma Tattvamasi and say Atma Atattvamasi. Let's take that also. Atma, you are not Ishvara. So what is the big information from that?
That has to be 9 times.
Nine times. You are not Ishvara. I already know that, Baba. If you have something more to say, tell me. To know that gold is gold and iron is iron. Do you need physics? Do you need a jeweler to come and tell you gold is gold, iron is iron? You know it. So if there is a body of knowledge, if there is a pramana, It should tell you more than what you know, no? Otherwise, what's the point? Physics should tell me more. You study and then you say, gold is gold, iron is iron. I already know that. But both are matter and it's convertible. Therefore, it's only a molecular structure difference. All that you need physics to tell you. So similarly, you are not Ishvara is not any new information. What information is there? I'm a jiva. Pata, if there is something more, tell me. I don't need a pramana to come and tell me what I already know. It becomes tautology. It becomes vyartham. It becomes anuvada at the most. It doesn't become a pramana. You are restating what I already know. So there is no pramanam there. There is no new knowledge being gained. What is a pramana? I said, thoda beech mein question puchna achcha hai to remind you all. What is a pramana?
Means of knowledge.
Pramakaranam. Remember the Sanskrit terms now. Yeah, advanced class abhi. Brahma Sutra sab ho gaya. Okay, it's advanced. Abhadita. Pramajanakam, basic definition. That which gives you knowledge is pramana. Then what type of knowledge? Abhadita, anadigata, jnana, janakam. Abhaditam jnanam, a knowledge that cannot be negated. That abhaditam is used to negate examples of rope snake, etc. You can't take the snake as real because the pramana has not functioned properly there. Therefore, abhaditam jnanam, anadigatam jnanam, knowledge which is not gained by any other pramana. Ishvara and I are different, I already know. So, if Upanishad is coming and telling me Ishvara and I are different, it is the knowledge doesn't become anadigatam. My perception told me that. If it is not anadigatam jnanam, it is adigatam, it is already known. Therefore, the definition will not be tenable. Therefore, abhadita, anadigata, jnana janakam, pramanam. Therefore, if you apply that, tasyatvamasi, your vikara, vishara, etc. is not applicable. Why is vikara not applicable? Because with the pramana definition. By looking at the definition of pramana, why is the vikara theory not applicable?
Because it can't be modified.
Anadigatam, meaning not gained by any other source. Apply that. Why vikara is not possible? Let me think.
Not gained by any other pramana.
So which pramana tells you? Which pramana tells you that the world is vikara? Science tells you that, na? Big Bang theory is what? It is not.
It is not.
Not it is vikara. So it is vikara is already known. If the Shastra was telling you it is vikara, that is known by other means of knowledge like science, etc.
No, it tells you that you are not.
So it tells you it is not. What was my question? Which is the other pramana which will negate this vikara argument? Because it doesn't become anadigatam, no? If the pramana of Vedanta is also telling you it is vikara, then does it become anadigatam? Because adhigatam by science.
No, by direct perception we can see, na. Anything is it is going to change.
Correct. Because science is based on perception, etc. But it requires more. See, by perception alone you cannot come to Big Bang theory.
Inference,
a lot of other this is necessary. A lot of build-up is necessary. Therefore, and it can neither be an amsha or vikara. Tattvamasi cannot be saying that you are a part of Ishvara or you are a modification of Ishvara. Both is not possible. Am I making sense here in this for all of you? Because I am seeing some blank faces. Okay. Because the possibility of misinterpreting Tattvamasi is what we are examining now. Because it's a sentence. Remember one thing. The spoken word or the written word for that matter is open to interpretations. Isn't it true? Can anything not be interpreted? You have to be in a relationship to know that. Anything you say can be interpreted in 10 different ways, correct or not? Yeah. Anything you say can be interpreted. Do I look fat in this dress? If you're a smart man, you'll never answer that. But if you're a smart man and you don't answer that, and she checks up with another lady, she'll say, yeah, I think you look fat. What was that? Was that so difficult for you to say it? It is better that you face it, that the least of the problems you'll face. Anything else will become the worst problem. Why? Because any statement can be interpreted. Silence can also be interpreted. Silence can be interpreted even more. Even more. So because of that, there are even Tattvamasi, an Upanishadic statement, is open to interpretation or misinterpretations. So that is why, to prevent any possibility of misinterpretation, we have certain definitions, like what a pramana is. Unless it fulfills these conditions, the Upanishad is not functioning as a pramana. Number one. What is the other thing to make misinterpretations difficult? You have seen this in Vedanta Sara. If I reframe the question, all of you will say, yeah, get it. How do you interpret what Vedanta says?
We believe the
huh?
We have faith in the
Shastra.
Tatpara Nishtya, Shadlinga Vichara. That's why I said, when I reframe it, you will get it. But what is that? Why is that Shadlinga Vichara kept like that? To ascertain exactly what the Shastra is saying. You remember the Shadlinga Vichara, no? Yeah, eh? Let's revise it. What is said before, what is said later. Purva and Apara should be in harmony. How you began and how you ended should be in harmony. You can't start one place and end somewhere else. Then what you are saying, you are contradicting yourself. Then, second point?
Logic.
Upapatti. Logic has to be there, yes? It has to be logically presented. Arthavada, praise or criticism to highlight what is important.
Repetition.
Huh? Repetition. Abhyasa, because it cannot be a stray statement, it has to be consistently said. Phalam, the result. It should be meaningful. It should have a purpose. What is the point in saying something which is not purposeful? So the Shad Lingas like this. One more is there. Which is that? Apurvata. Very important. Uniqueness.
What the purpose was the unique.
Yeah. Anadigatam it should be. What is gain? Uniqueness meaning what is gained by this cannot be gained by another pramana. That brings in the uniqueness. So by all these, we try to prevent misinterpretations so that you get the correct meaning of what the Shastra is saying. Okay? Which will, you will find it being some part or the other being used in all these verses now. Okay? Because the learning cannot be disjointed. Ha, Tatpara Nishtha is done like this. Then how do you interpret this verse? No, that I am looking at it logically. No, you have to look at it with respect to the Tatpara Nishtha. Because now we are talking of interpretation. Okay, now look at it. Jivatmana pravishtatva swamayaya srishtimurtishu niramsho nirvikaroso shutya yuktya cha gamyate gatakasha vikarova na amsho va vyato yatha. He gives you a quotation from the Shruti actually here. Jivatmanaha pravishtatvat. So mayaya. Tad srishtva tadeva anupravishat. This is Upanishadic statement. Having created, he entered. Having created the human being, He entered the human being. Anupravesha Shruti. We saw that even in the Brahma Sutras, one of the prakriyas were there, Anupravesha Shruti. Okay?
Taittiriya Upanishad.
Hmm?
Directly from Taittiriya Upanishad.
Taittiriya. From Taittiriya it is. Yes? Now, what does it say? The Jivatma is nothing but the Paramatma who has entered. And if the Paramatma is entered, then it is what? It cannot be entered in parts. You don't, do you enter a room in part? Supposing you are standing at the door, one leg inside, one leg outside. What will the host say? Arya, bahar kyun khada hai? Andar aa jao. Or get lost, go. Don't be. So you don't enter in parts. You enter as a whole. Nor do you modify yourself to enter. Change of shape to enter. For which he gives an example. What is that? Ghatakashaha. The space that has entered the pot. The space that is manifest in the pot when the pot was created. The space that was manifest in the pot when the pot was created. Na vikaraha na amshaha viyato yataha. It is not a part of the total space, nor is it and modification of the total space. Why? The walls of the pot does not limit the space. The space exists in and through the walls. Therefore, he says, similarly, Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahman, that Anantam Brahman is manifest in the Jiva as I, manifest in this body as I, cannot be a part, cannot be a modification. Why? It is a limitless consciousness that is entering. Entering is only aupacharikam, not to be taken literally. It is only presented. And the word entering is said to make you understand that the whole entity is there. It is not broken up. The whole entity is there as it is. Iti shrutya yuktya cha gamyate, he says. You understand this? On the basis of the Shruti and Yukti. Yukti is your logic. That means like pot space is one with all pervading space. Similarly, the Jiva is nothing but Ishvara itself. Okay? Therefore, the Yukti part of it has come in. The Pramanam, Pramanam has come in because Apurvata is there. This is something unique. Only the Upanishad tells you that. No other body of literature tells you that. No, Gita also. Gita, all that is part of the whole literature. Yeah. Anywhere else if it is said, if it is consistently said, we accept that also, not an issue. Wherever it is consistently presented, we accept it. Not an issue. Okay. Then, this much clear? Okay. Then another possibility of misinterpretation. What is that? You know, not to be taken literally. Just praising. Look at it. Throm Indro asti iti vad vakyam. Na khaluhu stutiyat tat param. You are Indra, you are Chandra, etc. Olden days praise, you are like Indra. Or you don't say you are like Indra. There's a difference between a simile and a, what is the other term?
Metaphor.
And a metaphor, yeah. The word like comes in becomes a simile. It's a metaphor here. You are Indra. Hey, iska vajra ayudham sab kidhar hai? You don't ask. It's just praise, you know. It's not to be taken literally. Like a sadhu, pakkad hai, bhikshu hai, maharaj, is called maharaj. Is he a maharaja? Where is his kingdom? Maharaja means emperor. Kingdom nahi hai, emperor kidhar, ghar nahi hai. It is a praise. Stutihi. Maharaj. Of course, there is one community in India who will call their cooks also Maharaj. It only shows how much importance they give food. That's it. Stuti. See, it fits in. It fits in. Stuti it is. He's not little Maharaj. But he's like considered king in his kitchen, in the kitchen.
He provides the food.
Yeah, he provides it. Stuti. So similarly, the jiva is this thing. It cannot be that easy. Why? Have you ever seen a praise when somebody is called as Ishwara, etc.? Udna praise kidhar, sunaya kidhar?
Suna.
Aap Bhagwani hai, suna hai. So these two, he takes it together. This metaphor and the simile, he answers together. Let's look at the simile also. Na sadrishya param vakyam. Agni manavaka adiva. न कार्य कारणत्वस्य साधनम रुद्गटा आदिव. ओके, ही सेज न सादृश्य परम वाक्यम. न सादृश्य परम, सादृश्यम इज सिमिली. ओके, अग्निः मानवकः, दिस पर्सन इज द स्टूडेंट इज फायर. Meaning he is sharp, he is bright, he gets things fast. So these are used as similes. Whether it is what you call the previous one, you are Indra or you are this, all these are used in the same of metaphors and similes. Now, if Tattvamasi becomes a metaphor or a simile, kya ho jayega? What in the Shadlinga Vichara will not be fulfilled? Because Arthavada is there. If the Upanishad comes and tells me.
Anadigatam will be not there. Comparison.
Anadigatam will not be there because there is no uniqueness in the Upanishad. Plus, Phalam is not there. Shruti comes and tells me, you are like God. Achha laga. What is the Phalam? Kim praptam maya? What do I gain at the end of it? I still remain the same miserable idiot.
Also, you can say that is comparison. It is actually you.
No. There is no comparison. Tattvamasi is you are.
So then, this becomes a simile then?
I think, Kavita, you are missing the point. What is being said? It cannot be a simile or a metaphor. Why it cannot be a simile or a metaphor? We go step by step. Why is it not a simile or a metaphor? Because then these two points are not fulfilled. Anadigatam will not be there. Phalam is not be there. Getting it?
Yeah.
Yeah. More than no phalam, no result. What is the result? Shruti came and praised me. What result is there at the end of it? Even feel good factor doesn't last.
So how is phalam defined
here? It should have a result. What is the result? Upanishad is moksha paraha. Therefore, moksha is the result. Okay, that is intended. So, where is the result? Any other phalam is also not there. What is the phalam? Phalam is at the most, I feel nice. For how long? 5 minutes. Obhi nahi. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ishwara aisa bolta hai Shruti. I got stuck in the traffic. One rain is enough to make me feel anishwara. Yeah. Nothing more is necessary. So can you see that? It cannot be praise or simile, metaphor, etc. Nothing like that. Na karya karanatvasya sadhanam mrudgatadivad. It cannot be karya karanam also. Like the clay has changed to become a pot. Okay. Ishwara has become jiva. Karya karanam. But clay pot is an example you use. Now that is also being dismissed. Can you see that? If you create a concept, we will negate that concept. Even though there is karya karana relationship between Ishwara and Jiva, we are dismissing that. Why? Because all karya karana relationship are mithya. If Karya-Karana relationship, cause-effect relationship was real, Ishvara will become subject to modification. That Ishvara will not be infinite. Correct. And the karanam is mithya. Is mithya karanam, not satyam karanam. It's an apparent cause-effect. Remember, cause-effect relationship has been dismissed as mithya. Whole of Mandukya was doing that only, no? Whole Karika was doing what? Whether it is Vaitatya Prakarnam or Advaita Prakarnam, it was dismissing cause-effect relationship is not real. Chandogya 6th chapter where Tattvamasi comes, there also before Tattvamasi is said, cause-effect relationship is dismissed as mithya. Therefore, there cannot be a real cause-effect relationship between Ishvara and Jiva. Because then Ishvara will be subject to modification. He will come under time and space. And if he comes under time and space, he is no more Ishvara. He is a finite guy sitting somewhere. Ah, a mighty character, all right. But all mighty characters have a fall. Yeah. So, therefore, Karya Karanam is also not possible. These are all elaborate points of discussion, actually speaking, okay? Yeah, if you have any doubts, think it over and ask me. Not praise, not Gavana Vakya, not part, not modification. So, a lot of things you have dismissed about the Jiva being. Can't be modification of Ishvara. One part of Ishvara became the world. What will happen? That part multiplied by so many times will become Ishvara. Yeah, it's important to see that. It's important to see that. Yeah, okay. Karanam is mithya?
No.
Then what is not going in? Karyam is mithya?
World is mithya.
World is mithya.
What is the apparent relationship between Ishvara and the world? That's where we started off. Ishvara is Jagat Karanam Brahman.
Yeah.
Correct? Therefore, world becomes a Karya.
No.
The universe becomes a Karya. Now the cause-effect relationship is satyam or mithya?
Relationship is mithya.
And why does the relationship become mithya? Okay, think. No, I won't. Think. The relationship of cause-effect between cloth and kurta is mithya. Why? No. That is a generic understanding.
Because then the kurta doesn't exist, the cloth is still there.
Because the kurta is mithya. Effect, karyam, is mithya. There is no kurta independent of cloth, correct? Mithya means dependent existence. Therefore, there is no mithya, there is no karyam, kurta, which is independent of cloth. Therefore, kurta is mithya. If kurta is mithya, the karanam, the cause of the kurta will be what? The status of having a karanam. The status of being a cause or the relationship of cause-effect will be what? Mithya, because it's not created a real thing, na? It's created a mithya thing. Therefore, the relationship of cause-effect will be mithya. Satyam mithya. When you say relationship of cause-effect is mithya, what you are saying is, the relationship is based on satyam and mithya. If I change the language slightly, you all are getting confused. Can you see this? And I am deliberately changing the language. Deliberately changing it. It's consciously changed. Because you should not get confused with slight change here and there. Same word. No, other words can also be used.
Shirt is cloth.
Huh?
The kurta is cloth only.
Correct. If the kurta is...
That is the right statement.
That's the right statement. Kurta is nothing but cloth. But you are not wearing cloth, you are wearing kurta. So where does the difference come? When I say I am not wearing cloth, I am wearing kurta, where is the difference coming in? Namarupa. Namarupa is mithya anyway. Why? Because namarupa is meant for? Functioning. Therefore functioning becomes? Mithya. Why? Because functioning is dependent upon? Namarupa. Good. Now it is clear. Abhi acha hai, abhi pakka ho gaya. That means, all that we are doing is, in the world, all that we are doing is, mithya. Iyam adhyasam puraskritya, sarve pramana prameya vyavahara laukika vedikascha, vidhi pratisheda, moksha paranicha, adhyasa bhashya. Very clear, na? The whole functioning is mithya. Lagta hai thoda adhyasa bhasha aur ek time karna padega. Can you see the whole thing? Therefore it cannot become that karya karanam that you we are see look at it. We say jagat karanam brahman. You said that. Then karya karanam is dismissed as mithya. That means what? World becomes mithya. Brahman becomes satyam. Then where is the relationship? Not really there. Therefore Brahman is always asangaha. I am always asangaha. What asangaha? There are always 10 people around you. I am asangaha. Whether 10 people are around me or not, I am asangaha. My surupa is asangatvam. I don't have to be away from people to be asangaha. Why should you be away from people? Asangaha. Only I am there. What about all of them? They are also me only. There is oneness right through. That is Vedanta, okay? Everything else falls short. Everything else falls short. Yeah. Everything else falls short. That's why you will find very few wise people having the need for time to themselves. Yeah, they need time for themselves to go to the bathroom and things like that. You know, to have a bath, things like that. Not more anything more than that. Why time for yourself? To sleep. Okay. Because body requires some rejuvenation. Other than that, what time for yourself? Unless you have some things to be done. Okay. Yeah. Some paper to be written or something like that. Preparing for the class? Classes, you say what you know anyway, so it's okay. Are you getting the idea that asangatvam, etc.? Because you are the only reality. In fact, that's what Tattvamasi is also saying, you are the only reality. It's presented in that manner of Jiva and Ishvara, etc. Meaning, what are you saying? First, you establish the cause for the whole universe, and then he's saying you are that. He is not saying you are a created entity that will become Amshaha, Vikaraha, etc. No, he's saying you are that. You are the basis for the whole creation. That's what Tattvamasi is about. Yeah. So that's why when all the possible misunderstandings are negated, then the meaning becomes very clear. Yeah. Because these are the possible misunderstandings. No? Whether you are consciously thought about it or the subconsciously thinking. He is raising it up and dismissing it. Okay. Okay. Na jiva vyakti gamakam goho. Khanda iti vad vachaha. Guna gunyatmakam vakyam. Na itad nilo Utpaladiva. Two other misunderstandings, possibilities negated. One verse, okay. Two more. What is the na jati vyakti gamakam? Like, okay, this involves little bit of tarka. We had done this man earlier. Remember, I made you all draw a table and all that thing? Yeah. If you have seen what one cow is, you will recognize all cows after that. You know what a cow is. One cow, standard you saw. After that, cows all over you will recognize. Why? See, if I ask you to draw a table, chances are 10 to 1. Okay, I don't want to, it's not a workshop. It is a workshop where I made you all draw the thing. Okay, in one class I had done it also. I think here itself I have done this. If you draw a table, possibly you will draw a flat top and four legs. Why? This is standard table in your mind. That's the table you recognize first thing as a child. But do you not recognize this also as a table? Even though it's not a rectangular top, it's a round top. Even though there are no four legs, there's only one leg. Why?
Because the understanding of table is where you can keep something.
Okay.
The lens is which you
evaluate. Different jati is there.
You, because when you recognize one cow or one table, you recognize the category, the class, the jati of tables. Jati means a class, not caste. Please don't translate it as caste. That was the English translation to prove India was a divided society. We have 18 castes, including Vishwakarma, carpenter, mochi, leather worker. These were not caste. These were groups, guilds. So jati means a group. So when you recognize table, you recognize all the qualities possible which comes under tableness. Under one word if you want. Tableness. Goho, gotvam. Goho means cow. Gotvam. So literally speaking, when you use the word go, not English go, the Sanskrit go or gau, you are indicating the jati, gotvam, the category, the class of cows. That is why when you use the word table, you understand what tableness is about. As you said, it has to be able to keep something on it. That means it should have a flat top. It should be stable. Therefore, should have at least one leg. More legs, more stable. Yeah. That's why that table will have six legs, if I'm not mistaken. Correct? Four only? There's nothing in between? Okay. Four legs. Yeah. So, stability. Stability comes. Therefore, these are what is known as tableness. Once you have the idea of tableness in your mind, any table, anywhere in the world, you will recognize. Therefore, the word tattvamasi is not used to indicate table and tableness like that jiva and Ishvara. Okay? Like saying, this is a cow. I'm pointing out. This is a cow. Or let us say a table is broken. I'll say this is a table. So even though the tableness does not fully apply to it, because it's broken, it can't support. But you still understand. You point out that this is a table. So it will be repaired and made into a table only. Not something else. Similarly, tattvamasi is not like that. That by understanding tvam, You understand jivahood, and Ishvara is a collection of whole jivahood. No, it's true, no? Jiva, Ishvara is totality. The word used is Ishvara and Jiva, two separate words. Therefore, Jivatvam, Ishvaratvam. If you have to go by the Jati thing, it'll have to be Jivatvam, Ishvaratvam. Ishvaratvam is only one. There's no Jati of Ishvara. There can be Jati of Jivas, class of Jivas. There cannot be a class of Ishvaratvam. Of Ishvara, there cannot be a class. Because only one Ishvara. Yeah, only one Ishvara. So, you cannot use it in that sense also. Or, guna gunatmakam vakyam. Baba, it's only talking about gunas. Neelam utpalam mitivat. This lotus is blue. That means you are equating the word blue and lotus in an adjectival relationship, guna. One has got the, one is the guni, the one that has the guna. The lotus is the guni that has the guna of blueness. In Tattvamasi, who becomes guna for whom? This is what to argue, answer the argument, Kalyana Guna Sampannam, etc. Okay, the Dvaita schools. It is true, Ishvara is Kalyana Guna Sampannam. It's also true that I have some of those gunas, in small measure. But this is not indicating gunas. Why? Because we are trying to arrive at Nirgunam Brahman, not Sagunam. What is the final thing? Not with qualities. How do you say that? Okay, let us take it as qualities. Who is a quality for whom? Blue is a quality for lotus, very clear. But lotus is also limiting that blue. You can say that. So here, is jiva a quality for Ishvara? Or Ishvara is a quality for Jiva. If Jiva is a quality for Ishvara, Ishvara will become a finite entity, full of jealousies, full of anger, confusion, and some good things, some love, some dharma, all that. He'll become like me. Then how is he Ishvara, number one? No, Ishvara is a quality for you. What are you talking about? I cannot create a thing. I can only create confusions. Very evident. I can only create confusion. What can I create? Because if Ishvara becomes a quality for me, I should be able to do things. No? That is pratyaksha pramana viruddha. Yeah. I cannot be Ishvara. My pratyaksha pramana says, hey, what can you do? Nothing. Very little. Meditate on Ishvara, all the qualities will flow into you. How much? How much? Some little creativity, some little proactivity, some small things. Kitna aayega? Will that give me moksha? I will find creative arguments to keep myself in samsara. That's all that will happen. More creative arguments to show, yo, I'm a finite limited guy, only this much I can do. Yeah. How much will you know? All your visualizations. You're living in a dream world, you're playing games with your mind. Yeah. I mean, if you don't have anything else to do, you can do all that. Some good is there. We are not denying there is some good, but it's not moksha. The phalam of moksha is not there. Some other good, whatever it does good, achhai. Yeah. In fact, we are thinking of alternate meanings for Tattvamasi. Why? Because direct meaning is not working, na?
Yeah. I don't accept my, I am an Ishvara.
See, direct meaning Tattvamasi. You are Ishvara. It is in Samanadhikarne. If it is a samanayadikarnam between the meanings of the word, there should be visheshna vishesha bhava. But because that visheshna vishesha bhava is not tenable, I am going in for lakshana. So how can it be guna gunatmakam? Guna guna is all, guna guni is also visheshna vishesha only, na? Neelam utpalam, that's why he indicated by that, by putting that example. Blue lotus is indicating qualities, meaning visheshanas, adjectival relationship between the meaning. Adjectival relationship means what? Some qualities. Because
I am negating all the possibilities.
Exactly. So all the qualities, not tenable, doesn't work. I don't have any of the qualities of Ishvara, and hopefully Ishvara doesn't have my qualities also. Yeah. I mean, if Ishvara is partial or jealous or something like that, mera halat ho jayega. Wo bhakta ko reward karega. Me to fool bhi nahi feka. Me ko kya reward karega? It becomes a problem, you know.
Yeah. What about the statement that whatever glory I have is equal to glory?
That's okay. That's fine. That is a functioning recognition. It's a functioning recognition that whatever you are capable of is given to you from the functioning standpoint. That's okay. That can be said. This is from the reality standpoint. Tattvamasi is dealing with realities. That's where the confusion comes. At functioning points, many of these arguments are valid. Even part and whole, yeah, functioning, what else are you? Yeah. But this is in the realities standpoint, not the functioning standpoint. If reality is a standpoint, okay? Yeah. Now another one. Na upasana param vakyam. Pratima svisha buddhivat na va upacharikam vakyam rajavad rajapurushem. Okay. He says, na upasana param vakyam. The sentence is not upasana param. Pratimasu Isha Buddhivad. Look at it. What is that? It's a stone. Funny shape. It's a stone. This is Shiva himself. He's a Shivalinga. Prana Pratishtha kiya. And this is Swayambhu Linga. Swayambhu Linga meaning what? Formed by nature, not man-made. That's all it means. Nothing more than that, okay? So, Ganga mein bodh milta hai. In fact, those of us, if you have been to Rishikesh Ashram, that linga is Swayambhu actually. We have not published it, I mean, we have not popularized it as Swayambhu, etc. Because it is found naturally on the banks of the Ganga. Nature formed it. And you did the pratishtha. This is Ishvara. Similarly, Tattvamasi. Similarly, Tattvamasi. It is meant for contemplation. Hai na abhi? When you do a puja and all, don't you do an Atma puja? When Vishukani you see, don't you have keep a mirror there for Atma darshanam? So this is meant for contemplation. You are supposed to contemplate your Ishvara. You are not really Ishvara. He says that is also not true. Why not true? Why not
true?
Because if it is contemplation, the words would be used, what? Bhavayet, upasita. Words like this to indicate the contemplation will be used. Bhavayet, upasita, etc. Here, none of them has been saying, presented, you are Ishvara. Asi word is used. And the sentences that deal with Tattvamasi, these sentences are not happening in the Upasana section. It is not happening in the Aranyakas. It is happening in the Jnanam Khanda, where knowledge is being dealt with. Why? He started by saying, knowing which everything is known. So very clear. It is Moksha Param Vakyam, not Upasana Param. It is Jnana Param Vakyam, not Upasana Param. Dealing with knowledge of what you are. It is not dealing with what you are supposed to contemplate upon. That later on it is there, Nididhyasanam, etc. Yeah, but Nididhyasanam contemplation is very different from this. Because in these type of Upasanas, it is Niskrishta Vastuni Utkrishta Vastu Aropaha. Remember Upasana definition. A bit time to be a little bit, you know, more scholarly in your approach of things and all that. Niskrishta Vastuni, meaning in a commonplace object, like a stone. Utkrishta Vastu, the highest thing. Ishvara himself is Aropitam, deliberately Aropitam, deliberately superimposed. Everyone knows it's a stone. No? Nobody is worshipping a stone. Who worships a stone here? It's a stone. Everyone knows it. It's a saligrama. It's a fossil. Saligrama is a fossil. Linga is a stone. Who worships a stone? Nobody worships a stone. But on that stone, you have done deliberate aropaha. That Jagat Karanam Brahman, which is difficult for you to understand and conceive of, is now invoked in the stone. And you are worshipping the stone, meaning as a linga for Ishvara. That's why the word is linga. Linga means as a sign. Therefore, there is a deliberate aropa there. In Tattvamasi, there is no deliberate aropa. He is directly telling, you are Ishvara. Deal with that. Deal with that. There is no aropa here. In fact, you are trying to negate all aropas. All adhyaropa which has happened without my conscious thought. In a worship, it is with conscious thinking. That linga is Ishvara is consciously done. I am Jiva is not consciously done. That's why this becomes an adhyasa, that becomes upasana, worship. This is adhyasa. That is deliberate. Yeah. Like we have, all this is religious nonsense. You want secular nonsense? Secular is not nonsense, nor is, I don't think religious is nonsense, upasana is not nonsense, nor is secular nonsense. On the flag you invoke the whole nation. And you play the national anthem, it is national anthem. It is not one, anything, small part anthem. It is national. You invoking on the flag. No, no. The High Court judge felt you don't have to stand up for national anthem. For this nation, you don't want to stand up. But when he enters, everyone has to stand up. So he's more important than the nation. Idiot. Yeah, it's idiotic, isn't it? And if for that he's going to hold me in contempt, he can hold me in contempt. The whole nation will hold him in contempt. That's how it is. So, that is a secular aropaha. But it works. It works. Similarly, worship is a religious aropaha, Vedic aropaha, Pauranic aropaha. Tattvamasi is neither, with a statement of fact. Why? Because by upasana, you are not going to gain moksha. You will only gain chitta shuddhi. Why will you not gain moksha by upasana?
Huh?
Upasana is a karma, manasikam karma or kayikam karma. Karma is? Karma phalam is finite. If karma phalam is finite, moksha is will become, your moksha, idea of moksha will become finite. That's not moksha. That's only a great experience. Some temporary rebate from your problems. That's all, not more than that. It is not moksha. Therefore, what is, and this is, comes under the section dealing with moksha, therefore is not upasana, it is meant for moksha. Therefore, it cannot become upasana param. Naiva aupacharikam vakyam rajavad rajapurushe. Aupacharikam. Okay? Like the king's representative is given the same respect as the king himself, generally. The ambassador of the country is treated like the country head himself. Because for that time, when you're dealing with him, you're dealing with the whole government. No? This is called aupacharikam. Not to be taken literally. Why ambassadors can be called back. Like Trump saying, I can't deal with this guy. Yeah, he made a diplomatic gaffe. He can't, he had to be called back. That can happen. But aupacharikam. Therefore, tattvamasi should not be taken literally. It is like this. Aupacharikam. You are treated by the Upanishad as though you are Ishvara himself. Since when did I become representative of Ishvara, by the way? Since when was I appointed as representative for Ishvara? For the Upanishad to treat me like that? Kidhar likha hai? That's why every ambassador has to present his papers, no? I have been representing the country. Since when was I appointed as representative for Ishvara? For the Upanishad to treat me as with respect. As though I am Ishvara himself. Kidhar hai? When you are born, these human beings who come to study the Upanishad should be treated like Ishvara himself. I say, is there a statement anywhere in the world? In any literature, anywhere? And even if the Upanishad were going to treat me like aupacharikam, let us take it argument wise. Kim praptam maya? What is the phalam? What is the phalam? I get more deluded. I'm a finite guy struggling in this world. The Upanishad treats me. I'm more deluded now, no? Yeah. The Thana hospital office is full of people like that. Yeah. It can't be. Therefore, aupacharika atmakam cannot be. Yeah. No, the Upanishad is addressing me. I declare myself as a representative. On what authority? I mean, how can you declare yourself to be the representative of Ishvara? On what authority? I declare myself as representative of the country. Go for a visa, you will understand. It cannot become an aupacharikam statement because nothing is gained out of it. Now, you can have aupacharikam statements. Every sports person or every tourist is an ambassador of the country, etc. That is aupacharikam statement. What is the result of that? Hopefully, he will behave like that. Not flick things from hotel rooms and things like that. So, therefore, there is a result there. Aupacharikam statement has some result. Idhar kya result hai? What is the result here? Tattvamasi means you are like Ishvara. You are treated like Ishvara. With the Upanishad on top of it. Kim praptam maya? What did I gain out of it? Yeah. Nothing. No phalam. No result. At least you tell the tourist that there is some result. That hopefully his behavior improves. Idhar kuch result nahi hai. You are Ishvara. So my behavior should be what? Don't be as you are. Otherwise, it will be a problem for everyone else. Are you getting the idea? So, all these interpretations, I am not going into too much of the technical negations. I am using simple commonplace negations. Okay? And all this interpretation is not possible because of one thing, one Shruti statement that he brings here. Jivatmanaha pravishtasau Ishvara sa shruyate yataha. Don't forget the Anupravesha Shruti. The Jiva is nothing but the Ishvara that has entered. Meaning, Ishvara is manifest as the Jiva. Manifest as the Jiva? No. Ishvara is the Jiva. That's the Shruti. Therefore, all other interpretations, whether it is Gaunam or Aupacharikam, etc., has to be interpreted in the light of that Shruti. Like space in the pot, Ishvara in the Jiva. So now look at it. Therefore, there is no other meaning possible except Tattvamasi is you are Ishvara. You are that pure consciousness. Now, how do you arrive at the fact I am pure consciousness, etc.? How does that Lakshana work in my mind, etc.? He deals with it elaborately by analyzing what is Jiva, what is Ishvara, etc., including the Panchakoshas, all that thing he goes into. All that he goes into and decides that. That we will see next class, okay? A good place to stop. Think over if there are any doubts, etc. Okay?